Well, let's see. I have Mario Domenico and Richard Tucker, and I've had Kurt Baum, and I've had John Vickers as my Canio. Well, that performance of Pagliacci in Portland, Oregon with the San Francisco Opera Company was really something. He was so intense that when he grabbed me in the play within the play, he grabbed me so hard, and he is such an intense person anyway. The next day, I got up and I had his finger marks in black and blue on my wrist. That's how involved he was. And so when we came back down from Portland, Oregon, back to San Francisco, we did Carmen. And in the third act, he came and grabbed me again. And I said to him, I said, John, I'm not Nedda, I'm Micaela. So we've had moments. To step in for one performance. And the night before, he'd had a very good time with his wife, and he sang the most fantastic performance he ever did of Pagliacci. That really was great.
Thank you.
because they always say now you 3 days before you can't and 3 days after you won't. So his wife was very concerned for him, but he opened his mouth. It was glorious, absolutely glorious. Richard Tucker, we had worked it out. It was sort of how he would grab me and throw me across the stage, but I never fell. I just swirled around and got to the other side of the stage. And then when he stabs me, I remember he stabs so that I fall with my head towards the audience. Yeah. I know that I sang with Leonard Warren in the old house. I think it was Kurt Baum there. Silvio, Frank Guarrera, of course, I had sung with him, but the Italian baritone, Mario Sereni, yes. Well, when I sang, when he was my Silvio, it was so funny. In the last production, I had to, or the production before the one that Zeffirelli did, he would have to sit on this stump, and I would be in front of him, sitting on the floor, and I would rub my hand up and down his legs. Well, that really set him off. He'd get so nervous. But I was doing the role, what can I tell you?
Oh,
Frank Guarrera was also very naughty. Very naughty when he was my Silvio. When we embrace to kiss, he gave me a French kiss. And I was so angry because I don't believe in doing that on stage. You make believe and you kiss on the cheek. So I said to him, I said, you do that the next time. I said, you're going to draw back a stump. And well, the next performance came and he again, so I bit down on his tongue. He didn't do it anymore. I mean, that's not nice to do that to somebody that you're not involved with. That's so personal. He was another one that always played pranks, like in Bohème, when a Musetta brings out the muff and puts it in on my hands in it. Well, Frank Guarrera had put a banana in that muff. Thank God it wasn't peeled. José Quintero. He was a great director. I loved it. I loved working with him. Because none of the other directors never sat down and talked with you and to tell you what they felt they wanted. And when a director tells you what he wants, you're able to do because he wants it and you want to please him. And it really worked very well. The Zeffirelli production of Pagliacci was very different. And when I saw what he was doing with Terry Stratus, who is so petite, and I went up to him during the rehearsal and I said, you know, I'm doing a few of these performances later. I said, you can't have Tonio pick me up and throw me into the cart. I said, he says, oh, but you're featherweight. I said, yeah, you want him to get a hernia while he picks me up and puts me on their cart? So we had to work it out that instead of him throwing me, he would sort of push me and I would put my fingers in this tray of blood and I would scratch him on his face. So that was very realistic, which was great. But, you know, he wanted things, and he wanted Nedda to go behind the boxes and stick out her legs and taunt Silvio to come to her. I said to the assistant director, when I had to step in to do the opera opening, the dress rehearsal and the opening night for Terry Stratus, she came down with a terrible cold and all, and I said, no, I won't do it that way. And in fact, Zeffirelli had Terry mount Silvio on stage. And I said, I'm sorry, there's not enough music for me to even get started, excuse me. So I said, I will lie down next to him. I said, but I will not mount him. No, thank you. It doesn't belong in the opera there. Why? Leave something for the imagination of the audience, right? Everything that is so sexual and nudity. Can you imagine in this production in Europe somewhere, the Turandot, these naked men walking around on stage for Turandot? What the heck has that got to do with the opera? I don't know what's happening with the directors and with their ideas and all, and what's happening at the Metropolitan with Traviata, which is such a beautiful Verdi opera. Why distort it by bringing it update and have men and women in tails and a clock on stage? What has this got to do with the opera? I have no idea. It distresses me to think that young singers that come and see these operas and think that's how it's going to be, it's wrong. They never think of that. If they have one singer in mind, they direct for that one singer. But what happens when other singers have to perform it? Dear. It seems that Verdi did update the Traviata in his day, and it bombed. He put it back to the period that it was supposed to be. Because people didn't want it. People go to the opera to see the splendor, the costumes and the jewelry and whatever, and forget about their own troubles and all, and be entertained. But when you put it in a up-to-date, and for instance, like putting Tosca in the Mussolini time, doesn't make sense. I'm sorry. I don't believe in, if you want to do contemporary opera, fine. But don't make the masters, Verdi and Puccini, all these, bringing it up date. It doesn't work. Ugh. Please. Mm-mm. Max Rudolf. I always called him Papa Rudolf because he was like a father to me. And I'm grateful of what he did by giving me all the lyric roles to sing first. Because as you know, I was a young dramatic soprano when I came to the Metropolitan. And if I had sung those heavy roles at the beginning of my career, I don't think I would have lasted 4 years. But Max Rudolf gave me Magic Flute, the Michaela, Bohème, Nedda, and Antonia, all lyric roles. And then I didn't get to sing my first Aida at the Met until 1959, which was great. That's why I'm still able to sing at the age of 85. Going on 86, March 1st. Pisces. And that's why I love the ocean. And I love to swim. I love the lakes. As a child, when we lived in Pontiac, Michigan, we used to rent a house in Keego Harbor during the summer. And I hadn't learned to swim yet. And I had a wonderful cousin. But I loved the water. I would go to the water and wade, but I wouldn't go any deeper. And so he said, why don't you learn to swim? I said, well, okay, I'd love to learn to swim. So what he did with me, he would put his arms under me, my body, and get me in the water and show me how I had to, with my arms and kick my feet. And as I was doing that, he took his arms away and I was swimming. But I would get up in the morning and have breakfast, and I'd go, my mother said I had to wait an hour before I got in the water so I wouldn't get cramps. So I would get in the water about 8 o'clock in the morning. I'd be in the, until lunchtime. Then I would go back upstairs and we'd have lunch, and I had to wait an hour, come down. Then I would be in the water until dinner time, and I was practically in that water until 8 and 9 o'clock at night. That's how much I love the water. And then I learned to fish. I would get a fish pole and a hook, and I would take a piece of salami and put it on the hook, and I would catch catfish. They're delicious. Catfish is a delicious fish. I sang Santuzza first in Caracas in concert form. And then I sang, I think I sang two or maybe three performances of Santuzza, that's all. Towards the end of the career. Well, I retired in 91. So it was, the late 80s. Mm-hmm. Yeah. In the 80s that I sang Cavalleria Rusticana. And that was another thing. At my age at that time, I wasn't going to run up those stairs to the top of the stairs of the church and come down the stairs singing. So I said, I'll be out of breath. I won't be able to do it. So they allowed me to come up a few steps on the side and come in that way. So I wouldn't have to crawl all the way up the stairs and come down the church steps. That was, again, Zeffirelli's production. Yeah. and a few steps down to the stage, because you have to take into consideration, I think I was now 60 singing, because I retired from the Met at the age of 66. In fact, I sang November 6, 1950. My debut opening night was Celestial Voice. The next year, it was Priestess and Aida. And the third was Tales of Hoffman, Antonia, in 1955. And in 57, it was opening night for Eugene Onegin. To think that I had four opening nights, two off stage and two on stage. Not too many people have opening nights that many. They have maybe one or two. It was a special occasion because the wealthy would come dressed to the teeth with their gowns and their jewels and all, and the man with their top hats. Today people walk in denims and all, and torn. I can't tolerate it at all. There is no respect at all for going to the theater or going to a special restaurant to be dressed up. They go in anything they have. And to me, this is disrespectful, I think. To walk in an opera house dressed like that, sloppy. I don't know what's happening to our culture and our people. They've become slovenly. Sloths.